Hello people, in this video we are looking at tuberculous lymph adenitis. Break this up. What is itis? Inflammation. Lymph aden is actually referring to, you can say, the lymph node. Okay. So basically, inflammation of the lymph node. Aden actually gives a feeling like it's a gland kind of a thing. But anyways, remember, inflammation of lymph node. There are a lot of other terminologies which you can see here. Lymph adenopathy, lymphedema, lymphangitis, lymphangioma, lymphoma. So each of them have different meanings. Remember, here we are looking at itis, inflammation of the lymph node. It can happen because of various types of infection. But here we are looking at what? Tuberculous infection. Very good. Tuberculous infection is caused by tuberculosis bacteria, that is Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and many other types of tuberculous bacteria are also there. But remember, in this video, we want to look at tuberculous lymphadenitis. See, this tuberculous lymphadenitis can be cervical. Like here, they have shown you cervical lymphadenitis. Can you see this image? They have shown you cervical lymphadenitis. Or it can be a mesenteric lymphadenitis. Or here, they have shown you that there is a midline above the suprasternal notch, another common site. Again, that will be cervical, I'm thinking. Here they have shown that it is there in the second intercostal space. Okay. And here, this image, they have shown you that it is in paravertebral region. Okay. So it is possible that this bacteria will affect lymph nodes in various locations. Here I will focus more on the cervical lymphadenitis. Okay. Cervical lymphadenitis means it will be this one. Your neck, okay, cervical lymph nodes. So here they have shown you multiple lymph nodes, right, are enlarged, inflamed, tuberculous lymphadenitis, and here they are showing you ulcer, tuberculous ulcer also they are showing you. Okay, so let's get started here. So the lymph node, when they have dissected the cut specimen, they are seeing here, what and all are they seeing here? Yellow caseating material with matting, okay. Matting is especially matting of lymph nodes, means you can say tuberculosis, okay. So remember, that would be matted lymph nodes for you will indicate tuberculosis, okay. So when you see this lymph node, what will be there inside? Caseating material, because you know about tuberculosis, you already know, no need to explain to you. There'll be granuloma, in the middle there'll be caseating material, epithelioid cells, giant cells, Langerhans giant cells, then lymphocytes, right, macrophages. You know this is a granuloma. Standard things that you know about tuberculosis from pathology. See, this is a TB lymph node. I think here they are showing you a granuloma, caseous material. This one is also showing you a TB lymph node. One more diagram of TB lymph node from the lab. So you see the granuloma here. In the middle you have the caseous necrosis. Causative organism will be trapped inside. Then here you can see the giant cell, Langerhans cells. Epithelioid cells, lymphocytes, fibroblasts. This is a granuloma. So basically, type 4 hypersensitivity, cell mediated, delayed, right, hypersensitivity. So type 4 hypersensitivity, cell mediated immune response by CD4 cells and by cytotoxic T cells. It can be the cell mediated immunity can be because of CD4 or CD8 cells. Okay. So basically the CD4 ones are actually the delayed one. So this part is the delayed hypersensitivity. So guys, lymph node tuberculosis constitutes 20 to 40% of extrapulmonary tuberculosis. So it's not affecting the lungs, somewhere outside the lungs, right? So extrapulmonary tuberculosis means where will it be affecting the lymph nodes, okay? It is very common in children and women and Asians and Pacific Islanders. Why is the disease caused? It is caused because of Mycobacterium tuberculosis. This you already know. It can also be caused by atypical microbacteria and Mycobacterium bovis. This is actually a gram-positive organism. But anyways, the stain that you use to stain, it's the acid-fast staining, Zeal-Nielsen technique. Here you can see, they are actually appearing pink here. These are actually gram-positive organisms, right? They have, they are resistant to acid discoloration, right? Decolorization. So these are acid-fast bacilli. Here they are showing you the same thing in ormine phenol staining. Brilliant bright green against dark background. Okay. So this is all about the introduction to this topic. Which topic are we looking at, guys? Tuberculous lymphadenitis. So we looked at what lymphadenitis means, why does it happen, and tuberculosis can affect so many types of lymph nodes, cervical, mesenteric, right, so many, and this is how the lymph node will look inside. There will be caseating, yellow caseating material. Matted lymph nodes means definitely you can say tuberculosis, okay. There are many types, we'll come to all this. Basically you understood who is causing all this. Mycobacterium tuberculosis, we'll remember, okay. So mostly the neck lymph nodes are affected, guys. 85% of lymph node tuberculosis will actually affect the neck. Okay. Others can be like this mediastinal, axilla, abdomen, inguinal. So you can understand that there's tuberculosis, which is, go here. Let's explain here. So basically there is tuberculosis. Tuberculosis itself can be pulmonary or extrapulmonary, right? Pulmonary or extrapulmonary. In extrapulmonary, you have many varieties, but anyways, we are looking at lymph node tuberculosis, which comes under extrapulmonary. Under this lymph node tuberculosis, so many types of lymph nodes can be affected, but mainly what is affected is the neck, right? Then you have the axilla, abdomen, inguinal, something they're explaining, right? So you have understood the concept. Okay, so 85% is neck, so that's why in the exam they'll ask you mostly about the neck. Now, what exactly is happening here? See, what happens, how does it go? By droplet infection, let us say, just like your COVID, right? Just like for coronavirus. So what happens, somebody will cough or somebody will be very close to you. So the mycobacterium will come through your mouth, right? Tonsillar crypts. So you have the tonsils. So through those tonsillar crypts, it will pass. How will the tonsillar crypts be? Something like this, right? So this is your tonsils in your mouth. On both sides you have. So now what will happen? The bacteria will pass through the tonsillar crypts. Okay. The bacteria will pass through the crypts and it will affect the tonsillar node or the jugulodigastic group of nodes. So in the neck, you have many types of nodes. So you should know, right? You have the Waldeyer's ring. Then you have the jugulodigastic group of nodes. That means you have the, let us say this is your jugular vein. Around it, you have the jugulodigastric group of nodes. So lymph nodes we usually depict in purple, right? So we will use this color. So basically, the lymph nodes around this, those nodes would have got affected. And remember, it's on both sides, because on both sides you have the jugulodigastric, right? So something like this, right? So it goes through the tonsillar crypt. Okay, we have drawn here the tonsils in your mouth. You have tonsils, right? So it passes through the crypts and it affects these nodes. Which nodes? Jugulodigastric group of nodes, okay? In the anterior triangle of the neck. Fine? See, the same thing they have shown here. This is your mouth, right? This is the mouth. And at the back of your mouth here, you have the tonsils, right? Palatine tonsils, is it? So let's use this color. Palatine tonsils you have here. Those are draining where? Here into the, around the internal jugular vein. You can see what is around the internal jugular vein. You have the jugulodigastric node. You can see here the arrow. It's indicating how it is draining, right? So this is very important. You should know the levels of lymph nodes, etc. Look at this. Here they have shown here, right? The upper lateral group, that is the jugulodigastric lymph node, okay? To here it is draining. Now let's continue the story from the textbook. Where is this? This is the in the anterior angle triangle of the neck. So anything in front of your sternocleidomastoid will become the anterior triangle. So that is where you are. It is draining. Okay. Then where are we? Okay. Sometimes very rarely the posterior triangle lymph nodes can get involved. Okay, due to adenoids. Now where are we? Same thing only they are telling, guys. So many other things can be affected, like supraclavicular, so just touch above your clavicle. Supraclavicular can be affected. Preauricular, that is behind the ear, is it? Preauricular. Submandibular can be affected, right? So various lymph nodes can be affected, like we told you, most commonly neck, in the neck also anterior triangle. Okay. So this much you have understood. Now what are they showing here? This is the lymph node. They are showing you that discrete nodes are involved and then they are becoming matted. And matted lymph nodes means you can be very sure of tuberculosis. Okay. So there are so many types. We'll come to this. Clinical features. How will it present? Tuberculous lymphadenitis presents as gradually increasing painless swelling in one or more lymph nodes. It's a painless swelling in one or more lymph nodes. Okay. And this will be over few weeks to few months in duration. So this is more like a prolonged chronic thing. Multiple sites may be involved. Then systemic symptoms such as fever, weight loss, fatigue, night sweats are common in especially those who have extensive disease. So they can just have this growth, or along with this growth, which is anyways painless, they can have probably fever, weight loss, fatigue, night sweats and all. If they tell you suddenly, you will say, yeah, tuberculosis, right? You're so tuned to this now. Right? So here you have looked at the clinical feature. Okay. In this clinical feature, guys, there are types of clinical types also are there, like acute type is there, hyperplastic caseating atrophic type is there. Okay. So they have given here a difference between hyperplastic and caseating. Say caseating.
Caseating.
Common.
Common.
Caseating is common. And say medulla.
Medulla.
Matted.
Matted.
Then say cold abscess.
Cold abscess.
Sinus.
Sinus.
Drug resistance.
Drug resistance.
Yeah. Body resistance.
Body resistance.
Not adequate.
Not adequate.
Thank you. So guys, so basically in caseating, what you can see is the medulla, right? The inner part is affected, right? And there will be matting of these lymph nodes, right? And whatever drugs they take, it doesn't reach here. It doesn't reach in proper concentration. It doesn't reach, or the drug resistance may be there in this person, or the body resistance is not adequate. And this is the most common type. Okay. So what is cold abscess and sinus? So basically, you know that there's caseating, necrosis, etc. So this can leak, form a sinus tract and come out, right? That pus. So, can you call it pus? So basically there is a sinus formation here. Okay. And this is exactly like what we told you. It spreads from the tonsils. Here they are showing you the sinus, multiple tubercular sinuses in the neck in front of the ear. So you can see the holes. This is like much above. Okay. So this is caseating. So let us look at the other types now. Caseating is the most common, you have understood. So let us look at the other types, just one word. Acute is seen in infants and children. Hyperplastic is where you can see the cortex is more involved, and there will be discrete mobile lymph nodes. Okay. And then caseating, we told you, this is more common. Matted lymph nodes, yes. With cold abscess, poor body resistance. It is seen in young adults. This is the one, young adults, you can say. Then atrophic type is where in elderly you will see atrophic type. Right, you will see that there are small lymph nodes, but caseating type with atrophied nodes. Okay, anyways, so these are the clinical types of tubercular lymph adenitis. Okay, if somebody asks you pathological types, also you write the same thing. Okay, so you have the acute type, then you have the hyperplastic, caseating and hyperplastic. Caseating is bad because it is indicating that the person has low resistance, right? Not able to fight the infection. Hyperplastic is where there is good body resistance. Atrophic and elderly, okay? Degeneration. Now we have to look at the stages of tuberculous lymph adenitis. Guys, look at this. So initially there is lymph adenitis, okay? There are discrete nodes which are non-tender, firm or hard. They are mobile, okay? And then comes the stage of matting. Matting is very, very specific to tuberculosis. So what happens? There is peri-adenitis, that is around the node, is it? So there is involvement of the peri-adenitis, right? Peri-adenitis happens and there is matting. So there is firm, non-tender. They move together in a mass, okay? This is very, very pathognomic of tuberculosis. Then you have cold abscess, that is deep fascia. So deep to deep fascia, inside the deep fascia you have this cold abscess. Basically what has happened here, there is no redness or anything. Okay, so basically this caseating necrosis of lymph nodes, it will result in a fluctuating swelling of the neck, but there is no local rise of temperature, there is no tenderness, no redness, no nothing will be there. Okay, but there will be a swelling, which will be a soft cystic fluctuant swelling. So this is cold abscess. Okay, cold abscess itself is such a important topic for you in everything, right? And remember that cold abscess can be caused not just because of tuberculosis. It can be caused because of leprosy. We'll tell you the other reasons also. Actinomycosis, Madura foot, all these can cause cold abscess. Okay, so just remember that cold abscess as such is one of the stages of your tubercular lymphadenitis. So even transillumination is negative. How will I write this negative statement? On sternocleidomastoid contraction test, it becomes less prominent, indicating that it's deep to deep fascia. Okay, so you will do some sternocleidomastoid contraction test. So when you contract the muscle, the swelling will become less prominent, indicating that it is deep to deep fascia. So cold abscess itself is a very important topic for you. Okay, this stage, cold abscess, draw this diagram also. Deep to deep fascia, you draw some abscess like this. Around it, they have shown the lymph nodes. So basically, there is no redness or pain or anything. Right, no tenderness, no redness, no local rise of temperature, but there will be a swelling, okay? And this can be caused not just because of tuberculosis, it can be leprosy, actinomycosis, Madura foot, is it? Did they say foot? For this cold abscess, guys, they will do something like this, non-dependent aspiration. See, they are going against the gravity, right? Because they don't want to have the sinus, okay? If you do incision and drainage, a persistent sinus can be there. That's why they are doing a non-dependent aspiration. And standard, they will give the, whatever is the cause for this cold abscess, for the treatment they will give. So guys, we are looking at the stages of tuberculous lymphadenitis. We saw lymphadenitis, periadenitis, that is matting will happen. Then you have the cold abscess stage. After the cold abscess stage, that is, it is deep to deep fascia, isn't it? Now it will try to come out, okay? So that time what will happen? There will be collared abscess. See, it has come. It will rupture through the deep fascia under the skin. See, you can see here, it is rupturing through the deep fascia under the skin. So there will be cross-fluctuate. It will be cross-fluctuate, adherent to skin. Okay, so this is collar stud abscess. See, there's a stud in your collar. Collar means what? Neck, right? So there's a stud there in your collar. So collar stud abscess. Nice name they have given, right? And then what will happen? It will burst out of the skin and it will release yellow caseous material, right? That is the sinus formation. Okay, so this is the, these are the stages of tuberculous lymphadenitis. Please look at it again. This is very important. So this is very important even in your ENT, I'm thinking. Okay, so lymphadenitis, discrete nodes, non-tender, firm, hard, and mobile. Then you have matting because of the involvement of the because of periadenitis. There's again firm, non-tender, but they move together en masse. Then you have cold abscess. It is deep to deep fascia. Very important. Remember, there is no sign of inflammation except the swelling. Then you have the collar stud abscess, guys, where it is like a stud in your collar. It has come out through the deep fascia and is just before your skin of your neck, whatever, whichever area. Then this will be adherent to skin, right? Cross fluctuant. Then finally, it will rupture out of the skin. It will form a sinus formation. It will give the yellow caseating material. Okay. That is why for cold abscess, what is the treatment they are telling you? Non-dependent aspiration. So that you don't, if you do incision and drainage, you will, you can keep a persistent sinus. That's why they don't like that. Okay. So here they are showing you the collar stud abscess from a different textbook. You can see the cold abscess has become a collar stud abscess. Here they are showing you collar stud abscess. So there is, it has not yet formed the sinus, right? So it is a collar stud abscess. Once it breaks open, it will become a sinus. So what are the stages of tuberculous lymphadenitis? You have the stage of infection, lymphadenitis, periadenitis with matting, caseating necrosis, cold abscess formation, collar stud abscess, sinus with discharge, yellow caseating material. Good. So you have finished all the stages of tuberculous lymphadenitis. Revise it once here on top. So basically, what are the stages of lymphadenitis, tuberculous lymphadenitis? Same thing. Lymphadenitis, periadenitis, cold abscess, collar subabscess, sinus. And what is the treatment you will give? For at each stage, they have said antitubercular treatment. Once it is cold abscess, they have added one thing. Non-dependent aspiration with antitubercular treatment. Non-dependent aspiration with antitubercular treatment. Antitubercular treatment, if it is if itself has drained via the sinus, then antitubercular treatment. Okay. So, what are the investigations you will do? So, you will do a lymph node biopsy, FNAC, lymph node biopsy, FNAC. You can aspirate the cheesy material and do AFB staining if it is cold abscess. That non-dependent aspiration, whatever you're doing, you'll aspirate it for AFB. Okay, and sinus, if there is a sinus, what will you do? You will take edge biopsy of the sinus, right? Edge biopsy of the sinus you can do if required, okay, for investigation. Then treatment is antitubercular treatment. Guys, is it fine? What are we looking at today? We are looking at tuberculous lymphadenitis. Very good. So we have looked at the stages. We have looked at what cold abscess is, how to treat, everything we have looked at. So basically, cold abscess where there is no sign of inflammation, where there is swelling, and it can be caused because of many reasons, one of them being tuberculosis. For cold abscess, there are a lot of differentials. It can be a branchial cyst, which you know, right? It could be a branchial cyst. It could be a secondary in the lymph node, secondaries in cervical spine, etc. And how will you treat the cold abscess? We already told you, non-dependent aspiration. Incision drainage you should not do because it will cause persistent tubercular sinus, and then you will give antitubercular treatment. How will you treat the cold abscess, guys? Can you say it again? So we have taken information from two to three textbooks, so that's why you're getting the same thing again and again. So antituberculatic treatment, non-dependent aspiration, excision of the nodes if required, then cervical collar or something there. Okay, guys, so then we already have covered the treatment. Treatment is what? Antituberculatic treatment is HRZE, right? So you should write that regimen. HRZE. That is isoniazid, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, ethambutol. This is for 2 months, and then 4 months you will give HRE, right? This is for drug sensitive tuberculosis. See, you have the other thing, that is shorter oral bedaquiline. Okay? Shorter oral bedaquiline, that is less than 1 year, they will give treatment for MDR-TB. Okay? And then you have the longer oral bedaquiline treatment. Longer oral bedaquiline treatment for XDR-TB. Okay? So these are some new things that are there. So the drugs that they use are like cycloserin, levofloxacin, bedaquiline, linezolid. What is this? CFZS. CFZS, clofazimine. Okay, so they will use all these: levofloxacin, clofazimine, linezolid, bedaquiline, cycloserin. So all these are the drugs that are used nowadays. Okay. So guys, in this video, we have so far focused on the cervical lymphadenitis, right? Just take a word on this mesenteric lymphadenitis also. They can ask mesenteric lymphadenitis in the exam also. Here you will see calcified lesion, guys, and some other varieties: acute, chronic mesenteric lymphadenitis, pseudomesenteric lymphadenitis, cyst, pseudomesenteric cyst. Okay, just look at these images here. Mesenteric lymph nodes, how they are, right? Acute lymphadenitis, they have shown something here at the bottom. And what have they shown here? Chronic lymphadenitis and pseudomesenteric cyst. So these are some words that are coming in: tuberculous mesenteric lymphadenitis. In the calcified lesion, basically there is no active infection, but there is infection. Okay, no active infection, but there is infection. Let me put this last. Calcified lesion, no active infection, but there is infection. Okay. Then coming to acute one, this is common in children, just like how you saw in the cervical one, right? And it will mimic acute appendicitis. So in children, you may think that the child has appendicitis, because you can see the location there they are showing you. Acute lymphadenitis, you may think that it is appendicitis. Can mimic appendicitis. Okay. Then coming to chronic lymphadenitis, in these children, there will be failure to thrive because it is chronic condition. They will have weight loss, appetite loss, emaciation, pallor they can have, fever they can have. The abdomen is protuberant, right? So you will have to differentiate these nodes from that of lymphoma. Okay, here they are showing you chronic lymphadenitis. Okay, nodes can be felt in the right iliac fossa. Now, last one we will go to, that is pseudomesenteric cyst. Okay, this one, pseudomesenteric cyst. Basically, what is a pseudomesenteric cyst? This will be confined to the two leaves of mesentery. Okay, caseation of the mesenteric lymph nodes, which are confined within two leaves of mesentery. Due to adhesions, intestine can get kinked or twisted, causing intestinal obstruction. So, two leaves of mesentery. Caseation of mesenteric lymph nodes confined within the two leaves of mesentery. Okay, so pseudomesenteric cyst. So these are the types of mesenteric lymphadenitis tubercular. Okay, calcified. Finally, there you can see no active infection, but there is infection. Okay, guys. Last one, terminology you look at, what is IRIS? Are you there with us, guys? We are looking at IRIS. IRIS is something like this. You see that the first patient is on antiretroviral therapy. He's taking drugs for probably HIV, right? Now what happens? This patient had tubercular lymphadenitis and he's taking retroviral therapy. What will happen? This guy will land up with an immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome. This is a new presentation of his previously subclinical infection. The lymph node may become bigger. Okay, so that is why I am thinking that when they ask you when the patient has AIDS and tuberculosis, what will you treat? You should treat the tuberculosis first, isn't it? That's what we said. Okay, so just remember this. So in this video, we have completed tuberculous lymphadenitis. We have looked at. Let us understand what this is. Basically, lymphadenitis is inflammation of lymph node. It can be caused by infection, etc., etc. And tuberculosis, that is mycobacterium tuberculosis, can cause this lymphadenitis, especially cervical very common, that's your neck lymph nodes. This is extra pulmonary form of your tuberculosis, and that to the anterior triangle of your neck. Okay, so the lymph nodes which are there, that is the jugulodigastric, all that, those can get inflamed. Okay, and it's not that it will just happen in the neck, it can happen the lymph nodes in your mediastinum, that is intrathoracic, or your paravertebral. Here they are showing in the intercostal space, right? So many places this can happen. Wherever lymph nodes are there, it can happen, right? Next. So this is, you saw that how the lymph node actually looks when you cut it open. You will see matted and you will see caseating material. So who is causing all this trouble for the lymph node? Tuberculous bacteria. Mycobacterium tuberculosis or atypical mycobacteria, even Mycobacterium bovis can cause all this problem. And what exactly happens here? This is an extra pulmonary form of tuberculosis. So it is going via the mouth, right? You can remember something like when you it is going via the mouth, the bacteria, that time it is entering the tonsillar crypts, and from there it is entering your jugular digastric group of nodes, that is in the anterior triangle of your neck, right? It can also go to the posterior triangle of neck or some supraclavicular node, or we told you any lymph node it can go to. Usually it affects the lymphadenitis, most commonly happens in the neck and that to the anterior triangle. Otherwise you can see in the inguinal abdomen, axilla, you saw intrathoracic, right? So many places, all lymph nodes it can affect. So the clinical features will be that there will be painless swelling of these lymph nodes. They can also have fever, weight loss, fatigue, night sweats. Those are typical symptoms of tuberculosis. This is intrathoracic lymph node they are showing you. Here, because of the pressure on bronchus, it can give rise to atelectasis, lung infection. Because of pressure on esophagus, it can cause dysphagia, or esophageal fistula also can happen. Retroperitoneal nodes can be there, which can give rise to chylous ascites or chyluria. Okay, so these will be some of the clinical presentation. Because of all this, lymph nodes getting affected in different parts of the body. Okay. So what are the clinical types you have seen? Clinical features we should look at, right? Then only we can go to clinical types. Okay, yeah. So we are in the clinical features, clinical types. So basically, clinical types are acute type. Then you have the hyperplastic, caseating and atrophic type. So basically, caseating is the most common. Remember, caseating is where you have in the medulla, there will be caseating material. The peri-adenitis also can happen, because of which there will be matting of lymph nodes. This is a very common one. Whenever you see matting of lymph nodes, it is very pathognomic of tuberculosis. This happens, caseating type happens, because the patient's body resistance is less, and they can also have drug-resistant TB. Also, or the drugs are not reaching where it has to reach in the proper concentration. So these people will develop a cold abscess and then a sinus formation, right? And what will you see here? That's it, right? This is very common. The other type is the atrophic type, which happens in elderly. So acute, caseating, hyperplastic, atrophic. So this also can be called as clinical types or pathological types, okay? Now, stages of tuberculous lymphadenitis that you have seen in this photo, you have this first stage is nothing but the lymphadenitis. Discrete nodes are, you can see, separate nodes, non-tender, firm or hard, and these are mobile, remember, these individual are mobile. But then what happens, because of peri-adenitis, these lymph nodes will kind of stick to each other, there will be matting. This is very typical of tuberculosis, right? And this will be a mass which moves together. Okay, firm, non-tender again, there's no pain in this person. Then it will go to cold abscess stage. You can see here, there's an abscess formation here, deep to the deep fascia. This will basically, there will be swelling, but there will be no other redness or tenderness or pain or one more thing you should see. That is, there will be no local rise of temperature, etc. And this will be a soft, cystic, fluctuating swelling. Transillumination will be negative, okay. And whenever you do sternocleidomastoid contraction test, it will become less prominent because it is deep to the deep fascia. Okay, so cold abscess is not only specific to tuberculosis, it can happen in leprosy, actinomycosis, Madura foot, etc. Now what will happen, this cold abscess now has started coming out of the deep fascia, but it is still within the skin. So there will be a stud in the collar. This is a collar stud abscess, which will be cross fluctuant adhering to skin. It is deep to the skin, but it is above the deep fascia. Then after that, what will happen? This will rupture and all the yellow caseating material will come out, and this is the sinus formation, which is the last stage. Okay. So these are the stages of lymphadenitis. Then what we saw? We saw that cold abscess specifically we have looked at. So you should not confuse it with branchial cyst. And you have to, if cold abscess is there, you can do an aspiration, that is a non-dependent aspiration. If you do an incision and drainage, it will leave a sinus tract. So you should always do a non-dependent aspiration. And you should always give these people, you will aspirated material, you will check for acid-fast bacilli and you will give antituberculum treatment, right? Then what investigations you will do, we just now told you can do a chest x-ray, FNAC, biopsy. And you will basically do an aspiration. How, what aspiration will you do? You will do a non-dependent aspiration against the gravity you are doing, okay? And then you will check for acid-fast bacilli, and based on the RNTCP guidelines, you will grade the tuberculosis, isn't it? 1 plus, 2 plus, etc. Then coming to the treatment, you will give HRZE, HRE, standard treatments. If it is drug resistant, you will give the short oral bedaquilin, long oral bedaquilin, etc. treatments, okay? That's it. And there is also mesenteric lymphadenitis, not just cervical lymphadenitis. In mesenteric lymphadenitis, you can have acute, which can mimic an appendicitis. Chronic lymphadenitis, the children may have failure to thrive. And then you have pseudo-mesenteric cyst. You also have calcified lesion where there will be no active infection, but there will be infection. Okay. So then we saw that if a person is having AIDS or HIV and he's on retroviral therapy, he can have immune reconstitution, inflammatory syndrome. This is when there is a subclinical infection which starts presenting because of antiretroviral therapy. Okay. So that's it, guys. In this video, we have looked at tuberculous lymphadenitis. Both the cervical and mesenteric we have finished. Hope you have learned something, people. Bye-bye.